Our next speaker is able to do good excision. He's come to us from Bordeaux, France. He is a very experienced surgeon, a great man. I'd like to introduce Horace Roman.
Thank you very much. So, ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Chairman, dear David, Tamer, Dan, I'm very grateful to be involved in your meeting, and you have to know that I will spend 2 days here and 2 days in the plane, but honestly, I think it is totally justified because I was involved in an excellent meeting, and I think the best I have seen for years. So I'm very pleased to speak to you about a topic, a very fashionable topic, about the best strategy to propose, the strategy of management in women with deep severe endometriosis involving the colon and the rectum and pregnancy wish. And the message is don't worry the patients. So why colorectal endometriosis? Because the colorectal endometriosis is the most frequent very severe localization of the disease, and there is a myriad of papers about this localization, so we can conclude on a strategy. So let's see that we are somewhere in France or in the United States, and you have a very, very typical, classical situation where a young woman, 30-year-old, stopped the pill to get pregnant. And she has always had dysmenorrhea, but not very severe. But once the pill was stopped, she becomes very painful, and 3 or 4 months after, the endometriosis is revealed, and it is a big one, a colorectal endometriosis. So she's referred to a doctor, and the doctor asks her, this is the question not to ask, what is your priority, relieving pain or getting pregnant? And the patient will answer getting pregnant, of sure. And the doctor will say, well, in this case, you need first one or several IVF, and then we will see. And this question should never be asked because it suggests that the two goals, relieving pain and reaching pregnant, cannot be accomplished in the same time. And this is completely wrong. And a patient, you and your old patients, so you know very well that once someone tell you you have an endometriosis, you think immediately about the infertility. So the pregnancy wish becomes the first objective. So she will undergo IVF, but is she still infertile? Because she has just attempted for 4 months to get pregnant. And my colleague physician who asked the question, he is based his conviction on guidelines, and the guidelines are very similar between several countries, because we have no randomized trial comparing the surgery to IVF. So, guidelines say that there is no strong recommendation to do the surgery before the IVF, because nobody demonstrated that the results of IVF would be improved. So this is the conclusion. But I think that this conclusion is misunderstood because, and they say in asymptomatic patients. However, asymptomatic patients with deep endometriosis are not very numerous. If you ask the good questions, you find them symptomatic. And when you speak about symptoms, everybody thinks about pain, dysmenorrhea, chronic pelvic pain. But there are other symptoms, much more embarrassing, much more severe than the simple dysmenorrhea or chronic pain. Deep dyspareunia. Deep dyspareunia is an infertility risk because you cannot have sexual intercourse, you cannot have natural pregnancy. But it is frequently overlooked by the ART physicians. Dysuria. Dysuria for me is the worst symptom a patient may present because it shows that the splanchnic nerves destined to the bladder have already been injured, and it's the huge risk of definitive self-catheterization. Dysuria is not pain, but it's a very, very severe symptoms. The blotting. Blotting and constipation during periods may not be painful, but it's very severe symptoms because the patient may have bowel occlusion. Every year, I have to manage at least one patient with stoma due to occlusion. And I used to manage several patients with suboclusive lesions. Silent kidney. If you have a stenosis of the ureter, this is not painful at all. However, the kidney will progressively disappear and you will have a nephrectomy. This is not painful, unless if an unexpected pyelonephritis justify an echography and ultrasound, and the radiologist will say that it's very amazing, there is no more kidney. Sacral roots or sciatic pain, they are outside the pelvis. So one may believe that it is due to as a lumbar origin and refer the patients to kinesiotherapy osteopathy. No, it's a large endometriosis lesion and the surgery is completely justified. But let's say that our young patient is just painful, none of these very severe syndromes. So what she can expect depending on each strategy? Because French patients now ask a lot of questions. What is my probability to be pregnant if I do this? And what is my probability to be pregnant if to do this? And I think that in the United States, the patient are similar. So we have to give her data about the probability of pregnancy following IVF and following surgery. And fortunately, we have data. For example, a patient who has a colorectal endometriosis, no surgery by IVF, one of my best friends, Marcos Ballester from Paris, performed a study where he estimated the probability of pregnancy in this kind of patients. And he observed that if all the patients had three IVF, three cycles of IVF, pregnancy rate may rise up to 68%. 68%. However, the disease is still there, and the symptoms too. Now, what about the surgery, first-line surgery, followed or not by IVF? We have data, and many data comes from my own team. The pregnancy rate may rise up to 70 or 80%. Our colleagues try to estimate whether or not the surgery of deep endometriosis could improve the natural conception, because you know that women with stage 4 endometriosis and colorectal disease probably have a likelihood of pregnancy less than 10%. On the basis of a systematic review, an Italian team observed that the natural conception after the surgery of deep endometriosis may rise to 25%. So there is an excess of natural conception due to the surgery. And now let's have a look at our studies performed in Rouen. And all the patients are recorded in a database. And we started this database in 2009. There were 3,000 patients, and they answer questionnaires every 2 years. It's a huge database. And we can estimate the probability of pregnancy, the probability not having pain, the probability of recurrences. And I tried to understand whether or not in patients who had endometrioma, if you perform only endometrioma surgery or endometrioma and colorectal endometriosis, the pregnancy rate is different. The goal of the article was to show that if you perform the treatment of endometrioma using plasma energy, a kind of ablation, the pregnancy rate is not worse than after cystectomy in the literature. And I was surprised to see that performing colorectal management at the same time does not decrease the risk of pregnancy, the pregnancy rate. Far from more, we observed 60% of pregnancies in this group. While in the group of Marcos Ballester with first line IVF, I told you that the probability of pregnancy was 68% if all the patients have three cycles, but actually in his sample, he observed 45% of pregnancies. Here we observed in an actual rate of 64% of pregnancies. Then we put together the database from Paris and that from Rouen, and we try to understand if you perform complete colorectal surgery and IVF, what kind of results we can expect. Does the colorectal surgery decrease the probability of pregnancy after IVF? Not at all, because after free IVF, the probability of pregnancy is 78%, and we observed a pregnancy rate of 60%. So it was better than in his previous study where all the patients had deep endometriosis and only IVF. And here is my last paper. It's a paper where the patients had large deep endometriosis infiltrating the rectum, and they were randomized between colorectal resection and shaving or disc excision. There was a randomized trial with a very, very close follow-up, no loss of follow-up patients, and I continued to follow them up. And 4 to 6 years after the surgery, I observed that the rate of pregnancy, so the pregnancy I observed in this group, is 80%. And the majority of pregnancies were spontaneous conception. And even though I have a look only on patients with preoperative infertility, the patients with proven infertility, because prior to the surgery, they tried to get pregnant for more than 1 year. In these patients, the rate of pregnancy is 75% and a majority of natural pregnancies. Another argument to send directly the patients to IVF is that we have no time, so we have to go fast. So in this group, I try to understand whether or not the patient I refer after the surgery directly to IVF for several reasons, or pregnant earlier than the patients where I said, oh, you have to try to spontaneously conceive during 1 year because I feel it may work. I think you see in this picture that the patients with natural conception conceive earlier than the other one. Because to have an IVF, you have to check an appointment, you have to wait to have an appointment, then you have to have an infertility assessment of ovaries, then you stay online to have the procedure, the first IVF maybe is not successful, you wait for another one. So it's not very fast, the IVF, in practice. Now, we have also two studies where the patient in the same team or shared in two, one arm have IVF, one arm surgery. And this is very interesting to estimate the actual effect of each strategy. And this study comes from Sao Paulo. Paolo Bianchi is a surgeon in Sao Paulo, and he published this paper 10 years ago. This is not a randomized trial, unfortunately, because if it had been randomized, the debate would have been closed. So the patients could choose themselves if they want to be operated or if they want to have an IVF. And this change, this is a confounding factor, so we cannot conclude that the results are definitive. But he observed that the patients who choose to have surgery and then IVF had ultimately higher pregnancy rate than the patients who kept their nodule and had IVF. However, when I looked this paper, I saw that the patients took into account only the authors took into account only the patients who had the IVF. So they overlooked the spontaneous conception. And I called Paolo and I said, please go to your database and look at the rate of patients who had a spontaneous pregnancy. And he called me back and said, yes, you're right. In the surgical arm, we have 20% of patients with spontaneous conception. And in the IVF arm, we have 8%, 9% of spontaneous conception, which makes sense because the likelihood of pregnancy is rarely zero. It's less than 10%, so 9% is very logical. So if you put together IVF pregnancies with natural pregnancies, you have 50% in the group of surgery and 30% in the group of IVF. It's a pity that this study was not randomized. And then we have a look at data from Paris and Rouen put together, and we observe that if you perform a statistical analysis called propension test, it means that from the database we check the patients were very, very similar and or different only by the treatment, and we observe that is a difference favorable to the surgery and IVF versus the IVF. So this is not a randomized trial, but it's an argument that the pregnancy rate could be better after the surgery. Now, in France, several doctors said to patients, no, if you have surgery, you will be definitively infertile. They are not wrong, because you are speaking about the deep endometriosis surgery, but we also may have cysts of the ovaries. So if the surgeon remove the cyst without taking care of the parenchyma, the ovarian reserve may decrease, and in this case, the pregnancy rate after IVF will decrease. So it is frequent in my experience that in patients who are painful with colorectal endometriosis and bilateral cyst, where the fallopian tube are destroyed, I won't operate the ovaries, I just drain them and wash the cyst, and I push delicately the ovarian laterally, and then I remove the rectal endometriosis. Because in this case, the IVF results will not be impaired. If the surgeon perform a bilateral cystectomy, it is very likely that the patient would have a decreased chance of pregnancy. But if we focus only on the deep endometriosis, which is the most challenging surgery, you can see that the risk of complication is long. The risk of complication is long, but the rate of complication are not high. Rectovaginal fistula in our database, less than 3%. All colorectal endometriosis confounded. Leakage, less than 1%. Ureteral fistula, less than 1%. Bladder dysfunction, overall 1%. And these data are somehow similar to those in the literature. On the other side, we have 70 or more than 70% of pregnancies, and the majority of them natural. I think it makes sense to our strategy to propose the surgery in patients who are painful. But if the patient has a complication, postoperative complication, it does not mean that everything is finished. So we published another paper where we focus only patients with complication after deep endometriosis surgery, and you observe that the pregnancy rate was 40%, a bit lower, but it's not zero, and natural conception 80%. So these results are not bad at all. The problem is that we do not speak enough about the risk of IVF in these specific patients. And we are about to publish a study where during 1 year, I asked to all the patients who come with deep endometriosis of the rectum if they had several MRI without surgery between the MRI and at least 1 year between the MRIs. And I could found 43 women where the MRI allows to see whether or not the nodule increases during the two MRIs. And you observe that in 40% of cases, the nodule increase at least 1 centimeter in length, which is huge, and 5 centimeter in thickness. So we had a cutoff, very severe cutoff. And we observe that this occurs only in patients without amenorrhea, meaning that the patients had the contraceptive pill in continuous without pains, the nodule was somehow stable. So the nodule may grow. And what about if they grow? It is a risk, yes, because we always can do the surgery. we always can remove any nodule. However, the consequences, the functional consequences, the complication will not be the same if the nodule measures 1 centimeter or 5 centimeters. And I spoke about the stenosis of the bowel and suboclusion or occlusion, the stenosis of the ureter, kidney loss due to the nodule growth, large vaginal infiltration, larger and larger, this area, and the risk of rectovaginal fistula, because you have to remove a large piece of the vagina and the posterior wall of the vagina, the length will be a half when compared to the anterior wall of the vagina. And the nerve infiltration with neuropathic pain, and this kind of pain, despite the surgery, will probably persist and will impair the results of our surgery. So we can do on any surgery. However, it is better, in my opinion, to do it earlier than later. What about the IVF complications? Our colleague who performed the IVF has no look in the bell, because I think in a majority of cases, they would not have the courage to push the needle inside. And every surgeon remember several cases, very, very challenging cases. And me, I remember the case of the 26 woman. I saw her after 6 unsuccessful IVF. And during this period, she had 2 laparotomies, 2 open surgeries, 1 due to peritonitis because the needle picked the bowel, which was attached on the uterus, and the hemoperitoneum because it picked a hole into a vein, ovarian vein. So I had to manage a suboclusive endometriosis in 26 years, but in a patient full of adhesions after the 2 open surgery, which were due to the IVF. So the take home message. Surgery impairs the fertility, is wrong. Surgery of deep endometriosis is wrong, so it's fake news. However, I don't say that all the patients with deep endometriosis require surgery. This is not the message. The message is that we have to adopt a balanced strategy and not to push away the surgery, the idea of the surgery, just because the patient, the first objective of the patient is to get pregnant. Because if you have a guy like, let's say, Karl Lagerfeld, if Karl Lagerfeld had performed only 1 size of dress for every patient, I think he would have never been so famous. Because not all the patients, this kind of dress is not suitable for all kind of patients. So our surgery should be the same. And just a personal comment. I started the surgery 15 years ago. This is short when compared to then experience, Tamer experience, then experience. But I feel that the number of aort departments is much larger than that of surgeons of deep endometriosis. And the number of surgeons of deep endometriosis is increasing because all of us, we are training young doctors. However, I feel that the number of women with deep endometriosis seeking care increase much faster. I don't know why, but it is my feeling. Thank you very much. It was a big pleasure to be here.